artillery fire along a 40-mile front was the overture to the great offensive. Out of the moonlit sky there came a concentrated hail of steel, the like of which has never before been felt in the desert. When sun was up, Pathé Gazette and official war photographers contacted the advance elements, among whom were those heroes of the vanguard, the sappers. From sunset they'd been sweeping lanes through enemy minefields with the aid of detectors. On their heels came the spearhead of the attack, the infantry. Montgomery ordered a general advance along the whole line. The main enemy defenses were breached thanks to the superb fighting of British and Scottish troops. Objectives were gained at the appointed time, dominating positions captured, and then the British armored divisions went forward. No half measures this time, a great weight of armor which dealt fearful destruction. Too late, Rommel realized he had been outmaneuvered. Counterstrokes were unavailing. The boldness of a seemingly impossible frontal attack had taken the Africa Corps off its balance. After several days of heavy fighting, the Africa Corps began to crumble. The total strength of the Axis forces in Egypt at the start of the offensive has been estimated at about 140,000 men. Imagine then what had been ranged against them. The Battle of Egypt rapidly became the Seventh Battle of Libya as Rommel's army was swung about and driven into full-scale retreat. Anti-tank units and artillery were constantly moving up to batter the Germans and Italians out of Africa. The most powerful air fleet ever seen in the Middle East has been turned loose on the columns of troops and transport streaming westwards with the terse order to blow the hell out of them. As the great pursuit went on, our armor was operating in the enemy's rear. Confused enemy gunners were having to swing their guns all around the compass. But try as they might, the British ironclads were breaking through everywhere. In his radio dispatches, Godfrey Talbot, the BBC war correspondent, lays emphasis on our colossal air strength.
The air story is again of fire and destruction among Axis transport fleeing west and against Axis position. Heavy and medium bombers attacked the withdrawing enemy forces, and the high explosives dropped included some of our very large bombs.
This is what the Nazis did to the refugees in France. Now they're getting a taste of their own medicine. The Air Force is working at terrific pressure to keep up the hammering. The Africa Corps is reeling backward, staggering from the everlasting blows. Rommel's routed army is scrambling frantically to save itself from annihilation. Holds its breath as the Eighth Army pursues the reeling enemy along the shell-pocked and bomb-pitted road beside the Mediterranean. Every gun is roaring its song of victory, every gunner working like fury, knowing that at last the Germans are being cut to ribbons. Defenses crumbled out of the most savage offensive that any enemy has ever had to face in Africa. Twisted and burnt-out vehicles line the bomb-shattered coastal road. This is the kind of graveyard which our soldiers meet with in their chase. Let us give praise to these men in battle dress. Men of the home county regiments, the Australians, New Zealanders and South Africans, the Indians and our other allies from overseas. But with what glory does the 51st Highland Division fill the picture? A reconstituted division which has today avenged the loss of the previous 51st, which passed into eclipse at St. Valery at the end of the Battle of France. What a glorious rebirth! The North African coast is littered with the corpses of a stricken army. In the opening stages of the battle, we were taking prisoner almost as many Germans as Italians. Then the market was flooded with fascists. Listen to what Talbot had to say about it.
One of the present jobs of our forces in the desert is the herding of abandoned men, soldiers of Mussolini, let down and left in the rear by their German friends. They wait to be taken. The roping in of these flocks of forlorn, forsaken Italians is continuing.
And here is the man who outwitted Rommel, General Montgomery, the Axis Buster, with Air Vice Marshal Cunningham. With devastating swiftness from the west, there comes the weighty American move in Morocco, Algeria, and Tunis, which transforms the great offensive into one colossal battle of North Africa and the Mediterranean. And Vichy France is drawn right into the conflict. The soft spots in southern Europe are confronted with a threat of invasion. In one fell swoop, the initiative has been snatched, and the vast Anglo-American offensive has caught Germany and Italy on the wrong foot. The peril of a second front to the Axis looms large. Amazing air successes of the RAF and Allied air forces indicate that more than 80% of the total enemy air strength has been written off. With our cameraman high above the advancing 8th Army, we get a vivid impression of the great advance, a sea of moving vehicles sweeping forward. Behind a billowing smoke screen, more British tanks are flung against the now demoralized enemy. Tommy Atkins, the Springboks and the Anzacs, all the khaki-clad men of the United Nations have waited long for this moment. By their superb prowess and armed with equal weapons to the foe, they have made Rommel an utterly defeated man. The prospect of complete and decisive victory is high. Many a deadly grapple has yet to be fought, but what a difference it makes to be no longer inferior in weapons. There's no comeback for Rommel this time. This punch spells victory.